different than most of the talks in this section, where we have a lot of awesome mycorrhizal fungi talks. I'm going to be talking a little bit about virology and some molecular biology. So just to start off with, plant virology is essentially the interactions between plants and viruses. You can deduce that yourself. But this can be a symbiosis that can be either mutualistic or parasitic. And the virus that we're going to be talking about today is called DMVD10. Now this virus, DMVD10, is an endogenous strain of a virus called Dahlia mosaic virus. It's a double-stranded DNA genome, and most commonly infects Dahlia variabilis as a plant species. And I'm mostly going to focus on what exactly this word endogenous means, because I'm sure some of you may know what this means, but just go a little further into what exactly an endogenous strain of virus does. So an endogenous strain of plant virus is essentially where you have a non-infected plant. So we have pictured here a non-infected Dahlia plant. And within this Dahlia plant, of course, we have DNA. So DNA that's coding for the pink of those ray florets, as well as the green photosynthetic machinery of the leaves. And here is DMVD10. So DMVD10 being an endogenous virus means that this virus is essentially just a sequence of nucleotide bases. And as an endogenous virus, DMVD10 inserts its viral sequences directly into the host genome. So if we were to visualize this, here's DMVD10 inserting its viral sequences into a non-viral infected plant, and now you just see that that plant became virally infected. So it's a great method to infect other plants. Now another form that's also quite characteristic of endogenous viruses is that if a plant undergoes sexual or asexual reproduction, this virus is passed on to the offspring, and that is how essentially endogenous viruses are transmitted to other plants. And this is how DMVD10, the virus of interest, works in this setting. Now, a few other fun facts about DMVD10. It was originally observed first in Dahlia in Dr. Hanny Papu's lab at Washington State University in 2008. So it's a fairly new virus. Not a lot is known about it. However, we do know that it belongs to the viral family Colmobiridae, which is a viral family of double-stranded endogenous viruses. And we know that DMVD10, because of the way it is spread and the way it is bound into the host plant, it's found in every part of the plant. So the leaves, the pollen, the seeds, everything that the plant produces has this virus because it's located in the host genome. However, we do know, at least some studies have shown, that it does not really induce any visible symptoms. So that really leads to the question, is DMVD10 actually a good or bad virus? And that still is a question that has yet to be answered. So a few objectives from this research, knowing all this, was that we wanted to determine if there was a host range for this virus, DMVD10, in members of Asteraceae, which is the plant family that Dahlia genus belongs to. We also wanted to see if there were more members of Asteraceae infected with this virus, if there was some type of phylogenetic relationship present relative to infection. So in other words, is there a particular genus of plant within Asteraceae that has more susceptibility to this virus compared to other plant tribes and things like that within the family? We also had kind of a subset of this where we wanted to also see if there was other closely related viruses to DMVD10 in our plant samples, and this included Dahlia common mosaic virus and Dahlia mosaic virus. But for the sake of this presentation, we'll be focusing mostly on the presence of DMVD10. So the way we went about this was we had a two-portion part to this experiment. First, we conducted a greenhouse study, and this is where we grew plants in our on-campus greenhouse and harvested tissue from these plants. We also had a field study, so this is where we went to five botanical gardens and sampled plants from each of the botanical gardens to determine if DMVD10 was present. Overall, we roughly had about 35 species of Asteraceae sampled within the study. So a pretty good sampling across many different genera and tribes of Asteraceae. So the way I go about this, again, we're looking at an endogenous virus that's present within the host plant genome. So we extracted the DNA from the host plants, isolated it, extracted it, underwent PCR, polymerase chain reaction, to amplify the genes of interest of DMVD10 we were wanting to determine presence or absence for, and then performed an agarose-gel electrophoresis. And essentially, we were looking for the presence of this virus around 900 base pairs, which is actually the movement protein gene of this virus. Once we were able to determine which plants may have DMVD10 located within their host genome, we purified the PCR products and sent them to GeneWiz to be sequenced. Then we were analyzing those data with the BLAST program through NIH. Now, we found some really interesting results with this study. We actually saw that there was a lot of viral fragments of DMVD10 located in our plant samples, and we're going to talk a little bit more about what that means about viral fragments. But first, I wanted to get you associated with the DMVD10 genome. It's around 7,000 base pairs, consists of about 6 genes, 6 different open reading frames. And we're going to look at this open reading frame number 1, which is the movement protein gene. So the movement protein gene, if you're not familiar, changes the size of the plasmodomous modicite exclusion limit, so it can squeeze its viral DNA from cell to cell, which is pretty interesting and a very relevant gene to be looking at. So here's essentially what we mean by these viral fragments of DMVD10. So if you see up here, we have the DMVD10 movement protein gene, which is about 990 base pairs in length. And we have A through J, each representing a plant species in the study that had these viral fragments of DMVD10 showing up. And when each of these colored portions that you see for each plant species, that indicates a sequence of nucleotides that matched up to particular portions of the movement protein gene of DMVD10. So as you can see, this is really what we mean by viral fragments. We weren't seeing the whole entire movement protein gene present in our plant species. We were only seeing these little snippets, and we'll talk a little bit more about some ideas that come from that later. You notice that there's different colors associated with those plant species. Those just indicate the Asteraceae tribes. Wasn't going to really go into that too much detail. So a second gene that we saw amplified in our plant species was this open reading frame number 5, which is the polyprotein gene. Now, the polyprotein gene of this particular virus has to do with its reverse transcription process and things like that. So again, we're kind of going back to the same image that you saw a little earlier, except we're looking at the polyprotein gene, which is about 2,400 base pairs in length, A through J representing each a different plant species, as well as those colored portions, which are matching up to nucleotide bases that match up to the polyprotein. And again, we're kind of seeing these little viral fragments, and that really led us to ask, why are we seeing this? Why are we seeing all of these viral fragments and not the whole entire genes? So, some potential implications from these results. One is perhaps there is another mode of DMVD10 transmission that exists, and we're going to explore potentially pollen transmission. Again, there's not a lot known about this virus, so we can make a lot of speculations for other students to pursue in the future. And perhaps there are some results that there's this long-term co-evolution between the plant and the virus within members of Asteraceae as well. Or perhaps this is just a genetically related virus that is having these homologous sequences that are popping up within our cleaned PCR products from our plant samples as well. And for the purpose of the presentation, we're going to explore these first two potential options as far as how we can interpret these results. So pollen transmission, you probably have heard something about this, how viruses can be transmitted via pollen, which is a great and fascinating subject. So imagine that you were to have this dahlia plant, and you have that nice head inflorescence down there at the bottom, and we're going to zoom in on that head inflorescence, and if you're familiar with morphology characteristics, we have a combination of ray florets, so the pretty pink petals essentially that we see, and these disc florets that are in the center, which are reproductive structures of the head fluorescence. And we're going to zoom in on one of these disc florets, specifically the maternal portion of that disc floret. So what we have here is a pistil, which consists of a sticky stigma, style, and ovary, right? And we're going to label this species A or non-infected. And here we have a pollen grain that has a DMVD10 infected pollen grain, and we're going to label that species B. So a pollen grain from a completely different plant species compared to our maternal portion that is labeled species A. And we have our pollen grain that's moving and is going to stick onto that sticky stigma, And if you're familiar with biology, which I know all of you are, that pollen grain can germinate into pollen tube, which would penetrate the egg and then fertilize and create the seed, right? However, there is another fate for the pollen tube germination. The pollen tube can actually germinate, and if there's an incompatibility between the pollen grain and the maternal tissue, that pollen tube actually penetrates the style. And in some cases, this is how viruses are able to infect between plant species. There was actually a really great study that's cited down there at the bottom where they were looking at raspberry bushy dwarf virus. And this is essentially how this virus was able to transmit between completely different plant species in completely different plant families, which is a really great concept, something that might be available to research for students later on. Another possibility for why we're seeing this virus in other plant species, and what I would probably consider the best guess, is this plant virus co-evolution that's existing. So, in other words, is DMVD10 actually an old virus? And this is a virus, again, that belongs to this family of endogenous viruses, and this has been shown to happen within other viruses of this viral family, where actually when viruses are transmitted to other plant species, the genome shows up very fragmented and such like that. It's essentially what exactly we're seeing with this particular virus as well. Or are there particular plant viral sequences of DMVD10 that may be beneficial to plants? And that would be something to explore further as well. Or is it possible just that the results of this study are evidence that a closely related virus to DMVD10 is popping up in our plant samples as well? Again, a lot of speculations that come from this research, and it needs to be looked into a little further. But in my opinion, plant viral coevolution is probably the best reasoning of what we're seeing here. So we can form a few conclusions from this research. One is that we did have DMVD10 viral sequences that were showing up in about 37% of our samples, 13 out of 35 plant species, including the Dahlia genus. However, there really did not appear to be any phylogenetic relationship present relative to infection. So in other words, there were other genera of plants showing up with these DMVD10 viral fragments as well. This potentially suggests, as we just talked about, pollen transmission or some type of co-evolutionary relationship between the virus and other plants. In addition, we didn't talk much about this, but there were other fragments or whole entire genes of the Dahlia common mosaic virus and Dahlia mosaic virus that showed up in our plant species as well. And this kind of relates more to what we've been talking about, that there's some type of co-evolutionary relationship between this plant virus and members of Asteraceae. So with that, there's always a lot of acknowledgments that come with thesis research, so I thank these individuals and organizations for their help, funding, and support. And with that, I'll take any questions.
So we do have time for questions.
Yes. So did you use just one primary for these, or were you using multiple?
I was using multiple primers.
And then so you did Sanger sequencing?
Yes.
Okay.
With GeneWiz.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
Were these fragments big enough to have any function if they were transcribed or translated, or are they too small?
That's a great question. We're kind of looking into that. There's a great bioinformatics guy at our university, so kind of have to hand it off to him. My background's in a lot of physiology and anatomy, so molecular biology is a new thing. Yes.
Okay. Are there any specific regions in the genome that the virus would be certain?
I'm not sure. That's a great question, though.
We can have one more question if you've got other comments to get uploaded. All right, thank you, Gary. Great job.